Hello and welcome to Dialogue. China has released a white paper titled China, Democracy That Works, which comprehensively details China's whole process, people's democracy, under the leadership of the Communist Party of China. What does the white paper tell us about Chinese democracy, and how is it different or similar to democratic models in the West? To answer these questions, I'm joined by Xia Lu, Associate Professor at the School of Marxism Studies at Renmin University of China, Joseph Gregory Mahoney, Professor of Politics and International Relations at East China Normal University, and John Ross, Senior Fellow of Chungyang Institute of Financial Studies at Renmin University of China. That's our topic. I'm Xu Qianduo. Well, welcome to the show. Professor Mahoney, I will start with you. What's your takeaway of the white paper, China Democracy That Works?
You know, I think the key point is summed up in the title. It works. In other words, what we see is a results-oriented approach that actually liberates and increases the freedoms of people, as opposed to a system that becomes mired in and entrenched in sort of a circular approach to unresolving problems, seeing problems worsening over time, and not being really committed to democracy in the global sphere.
Well, Professor Xia Lu, you know, there's a catchphrase, whole process, people's democracy, the whole process democracy, sort of being unique to the Chinese practice. Tell us, what does that really mean?
Thanks for the question. In this white paper, the whole process, people's democracy, actually touches, I would like to argue that it touches the essence of democracy. That would be the rule of the people, ruled by the people. And the whole process, people's democracy, involves not only the election, this kind of channels for political participation, but also involves the decision designing, decision making, and the decision implementation, and especially decision review after the so-called decision or policy have been made. So the whole process democracy include not only the election, but also the policy making, the policy review, and other kind of state administration affair that would concern the people.
Mm-hmm. Ross, John, you know, China's Vice Foreign Minister Liu Yicheng said at another forum, he said that China's whole process of people's democracy is not the kind that wakes up at the time of voting and goes back dormant afterwards. What do you make of that?
Well, I think that's exactly correct. I mean, it's a bit of a joke in the West that the parties don't actually carry out what they promise to do. And I think, again, the title, the king is in the title. I mean, all you have to do is compare, for example, the position of women in India and the position of women in China. To see the difference, an Indian woman lives 71 years, a Chinese woman lives 79 years. A Chinese woman is 95% likely to be literate, and an Indian woman 65%. So the real life positions, that's the outcomes of the Chinese position of woman. The Chinese democracy is much better than the Indian one.
Mm-hmm. Well, Professor Mahoney, you mentioned about the results-oriented practice of the Chinese democracy, and John also mentioned this, you know, this, you know, whether it's just election or probably more than election about this democratic practice. Tell us more about this results-oriented democracy in China. You know, what about the performance of the Chinese like a governance or the democratic practice?
Well, you know, although the report does highlight the fact that most people in China enjoy universal suffrage and do vote in elections, and that there are a multitude of other democratic mechanisms in the Chinese system, it also makes it clear that there must be a balancing between the material needs of national development and the idealism of some types of democracy that are not connected with the material realities and needs that must be served. Now, as one commentator put it in a conference that was held on this subject in Beijing on Saturday, and this echoes the point that you made just a moment ago, China's democracy doesn't emphasize campaign promises, but promise fulfillment. But it does so, again, with various forms of direct and indirect citizen engagement, various forms of voting and consultation, and various forms of democracy between and within parties.
Mm-hmm. Well, Xiaolu, obviously, I think, you know, both John and Professor Maholi mentioned about this performance of the Chinese governance. For example, if you look at the past 40-plus years, you know, this poverty alleviation, economic development, from economic backwater to the second largest economy, the largest trading nation of goods, etc. I mean, the performance itself is outstanding, you know, but the Chinese democracy is a bit different. For example, there's not much highlight or focus on this. Usually it's noisy, it's a big event like election. For China, it's more comprehensive, much more than election. Is that the case?
Yes, because in the political scientist's view, election is just one of the channels, one of the ways for people to participate in political affair, for public affair. And elections, actually, I would like to argue that election is necessary. You cannot have an election by talking about democracy. Well, on the other hand, election is not the only thing about democracy. And when we talk about election, we have another concept called the turnout rate. Well, that would be the percentage of the people, the percentage of the citizen who come out to cast their ballot in each and every election. Well, as a political scientist, we always notice that some certain country, for example, the U.S., enjoys the relatively low turnout kind of rate in not only federal level, but also the state level, not only in the legislative election, but also the executive election. So how could you still argue that this country or certain country is a democracy, yet if their people wouldn't want to go out to cast a ballot? So as a political scientist, we will argue that the election, well, is necessary, and the election is important, but election is not the only channel or is not the only criterion for people to judge whether a country is democracy or not.
Mm-hmm. Well, John, obviously, yes, election is an important part of democracy. You know, whatever style we have, probably you will have elections to a different, varying degree, probably. In some extreme degree, you can say, let's have a referendum, like the British, you know, the exit of EU, right? That's a referendum, basically, everybody has a vote about the future of the nation. Not really probably happy for everyone, but anyway, that's some practice of democracy, sort of an extreme. In another extreme, probably low turnout rate, you know, what can you do if people's participation in democracy, there's a lack of passion, lack of enthusiasm, John?
Well, the point is that people participate to the degree that they think it will actually change the situation. Well, one of the reasons for the very low participation, for example, in US elections, and for even for a presidential election, it used to get down to only around 50%, is because they don't think it changes anything. And if you look at the real outcomes of countries, you can see why. Let's look at India and China again, because they're the most comparable, more so than, say, the United States and China. In 1947, when it became independent, India had a higher per capita GDP than China did. Now, as I say, for an Indian woman, it's 8 years less than for a Chinese woman. So the position of a Chinese woman has improved immensely more than the position in Indian women. And this is not a small question. I mean, Chinese women and Indian women together are almost one in five of everybody in the world. So people don't participate, and they don't think it makes a big difference. And all the polls showing high degrees of satisfaction with the Chinese government is because it's not merely a very good result. It's, to be quite honest, the biggest improvement in the conditions of the largest number of human beings in the whole of human history. So you just compare the difference in outcome between China and India. Anybody who thinks that the human rights of somebody in China are less good than somebody in India is just talking complete nonsense. And if you have a theory which leads to such a nonsensical conclusion, then that theory is obviously wrong.
Well, that's a good point. You know, if you live in China, I mean, also China is probably one of the safest country in the world. You know, you walk in early morning, like 2 or 3 o'clock, in big cities like Beijing and Shanghai, you don't have any fear. I mean, in terms of that kind of freedom of walking on the street without any worry, without any concern of public safety issue. Professor Mahoney, you are nodding your head. You have some experience of living in Shanghai, obviously. I mean, rich experience of living in Shanghai.
Yeah, I have the experience of living in Shanghai, but also sending my, some years ago, my teenage daughter across the city in a taxi to go to school. No concern for her security whatsoever in that respect. But you know, I think to follow on the to develop here two points. The first is, you know, we can talk about low participation rates in the United States as one example of where democracy is faltering. But you have to realize that that given also the fact that we have such polarization, that even among that low participation rate, we still end up with 50%, you know, roughly half the people who are deeply unhappy with the result and who distrust government and don't want to follow it. And we see this polarization echoing across all aspects of our life, whether it has to do with education reform, our capacity to deal with global warming, or even, of course, dealing with the pandemic. But I think in the case of China, you know, the first principle of socialist democracy is liberation, followed by the progressive realization of social justice. And this is what we see with the CPC winning the civil war and establishing the PRC in 1949, reestablishing sovereignty and pushing forward China's stalled transition to modernity. And we see this again being renewed and adjusted with each generation of leadership that follows up to the present. And so to get back to your earlier point about results oriented, you know, we've seen 770 million people lifted out of poverty. We've seen extreme poverty eliminated. And we've seen the establishment of a Shao Kong Shou Pei, a moderately prosperous society with more than 400 million middle income earners. And so we see an empowered China that not only handles its own affairs and handles them well, it also supports democracy globally, right? And cooperates extensively to address crises affecting all of us, including climate change, the pandemic, and peacekeeping.
Mm-hmm. Xialu, you know, one point usually, you know, people criticize China is this, they would say, you know, you don't have elections or high-profile elections. But look, you know, this is the former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan. Mr. Kofi Annan said, democracy includes far more than just elections, and it really makes more sense to think about the will of the people rather than about institutional or voting structures when we are trying to assess how democratic a country is. I think this is a good criteria, not only elections, but also much more about reflecting the will of the people. I still remember back in 2012 or 2014, you know, there's a survey about the Chinese people. What's your biggest concern? I think the top three basically is like, you know, pollution, corruption, etc. And nowadays, they are being dealt with effectively. So, you know, yeah, China does not practice that kind of election like in Western, you know, electoral democracy, but it does something more than that. For example, you know, it follows its tradition of meritocracy in selecting or electing the best officials, you know, to put them in the proper position to run a government, like a province or a city. And also political consultation, for example, the CPPCC, you know, top advisory body, to include opinions from not only Communist Party members and officials, but also like 60% of its members are non-CPC members from the society. So tell us more about that, how China is doing that, you know, in a comprehensive way to access, you know, democracy.
Yes, I totally agree with you about your previous kind of comments on this, the meritocracy and the democracy, the comparison. Actually, when we talk about democracy, actually, we have three levels of a concept, three levels to understand the democracy. The first level is democracy as the pursuit of a value. The second level is the democracy as an institutional design, institutional arrangement. The third level is a democracy as the technical means. Well, when we talk about the election, we actually refer election as the third level of democracy. So if you only consider election is the whole content of democracy, that would be inappropriate because, well, in some certain countries, people or the country or society pay too much attention and they spend too much kind of a cost in election. Well, that election cost too much, cost energy, cost attention. People ignore something after the election. People ignore the governability. People ignore the effectiveness of or ineffectiveness of the governability of the of the administration to solve the previous, I mean, to solve the practical problem. So, well, I would like to argue that democracy is a concrete phenomenon and it is evolving constantly. Well, in terms of the history, in terms of the historical experience of the CPC, actually, before 1949, in the remote area, in the northwestern remote area, in Shangan-Ning border area, actually, the CPC back then, in the 1940s, 1930s, they already practiced this kind of consultation, the whole process democracy, because back then, the CPC member took only the 30%, less than 30% of the cadre of the official in the border area of the border region government, and the other 60% or the other 70% would be non the CPC members, and that kind of region worked well, and that kind of region, well, the policy back then, well, were welcomed by the local people. So we could argue that previously the CPC had experience about whole process democracy, and it focused more on, it focused not only on election but also on the performance of policy and whether people are satisfied or were satisfied with the policy or not.
Yeah, a good point here. John, you know, whether the people are satisfied or not, you know, it's like a people-centered or serving the people, you know, ultimately, you know, whatever style of democracy you have, the ultimate purpose is to serve the people, to make the people happy, have them being taken care of, you know, by the government. Speak of that, you know, Professor Mahoney mentioned about this pandemic. If you look at the performance, look at the result, you know, the Chinese government, they're handling the prevention or the control of the COVID-19. I would say it's much better than probably the U.S. if you compare how many people were killed during the pandemic. In the U.S. is about, you know, 800,000 people. In China, much, much smaller the number. So, you know, in that sense, I mean, your performance proves, because in the past, at least, the people think, people would say, oh, this country is a democracy or that country is not a good democracy or not a democracy. Usually that means democracy works better than another forms of government. But now, I mean, China is outperforming many of the countries. What would you say, like a Chinese-style democracy or Western democracy?
Well, that's what I say, that the Western theory of democracy is nonsense. Of human rights. Again, let's take the pandemic, right? Yeah, slightly under or around 800,000 people have died in the United States in the pandemic. On mainland China, slightly under 5,000. But China's got a population which is more than four times that of the United States. That would mean that if you had the same death rate in China as you had in the United States, there would be 3,300,000 people dead instead of 5,000. Well, the most important of all human rights is to be alive. And therefore, what you have when people say that they should adopt, the China should adopt the US system, and that, for example, they're trying to campaign against its zero COVID policy, what they're actually proposing is that more than 3 million people Chinese should die in order to adopt a Western-style system. Well, I doubt very much that the Chinese people wish 3 million people to die, and certainly the 3 million chosen to die certainly don't have that view. This is why any theory, therefore, which leads you to the view that the human rights in a country are better where the equivalent of 3 million people die in China, and only under 5,000 die in China. This theory is nonsense. It's completely illogical. And COVID is an illustration of that, a very, very clear one. As I said, if you take the position of people in China and India, I don't appear to. I like India very much. I visit there very regularly. In fact, my last vacation before COVID broke out was to India. I don't want to criticize India. I would want the Indian people to have the same human rights as the people in China, and they don't. And this is the truth. And COVID illustrates it very clearly.
Mm-hmm. Well, Professor Mahoney, you know, a part of the reason, you know, now we are focusing on democracy is in the U.S. There's upcoming a democracy summit, you know, about defending democracy against authoritarian governments, issues like that. What's the true purpose of the summit?
Well, you know, I think that the position that many people are taking in Beijing, and it's one that I agree with, is that, you know, this is a situation where the United States, after 4 very difficult years under Trump, which, you know, culminated in what many describe as an attempted coup against democracy, an attempted coup against Congress, and all the other stuff that was done to undermine democratic practices, which have continued, not as viscerally as the Capitol attack, but we see a large number of states trying to reverse and reduce democratic rights, voting rights, especially for minorities and the working class. So we see that the United States feeling this intense pressure at home and the intense pressure or embarrassment overseas, but at the same time wanting undemocratically to reestablish its hegemony, its unilateralism after the failed years of Trump. And so, you know, it's creating, it's trying to reestablish this idea of the White House being the leader of the free world as a way to, you know, have this summit for democracy, to bring these erstwhile and worried allies back into the fold. But, you know, I think we always have to come back to the old Eric Hobsbawm description of hegemony being a velvet glove that mask the imperial fist within, and you know, reflect on what did the U.S. do in Afghanistan? How did the U.S. exit Afghanistan? What did the U.S. do in Libya? How did it contribute to the destruction of Iraq and the destabilization of Syria? What is it doing now to align global forces, to divide the world, and align these forces against China? This is not democracy. This is unilateralism. This is a type of even dictatorship.
Well, there's a point Professor Mahoney mentioned, Xialu, about, you know, dividing the world. That's absolutely the concern, I think, you know, especially for China and Russia. They talked a lot about, you know, the possible division of the world, you know, at a time of the needing countries to work together to fight climate change, to deal with the pandemic, or preventing another pandemic, you know, maybe 18 years' time. It requires cooperation, but now we are seeing is the world could be divided into different camps, different blocks against each other by having this kind of summit. Of course, it is also probably, you know, make some other countries, I mean, a lot of countries unhappy about, you know, the summit itself by not inviting or by inviting this and that. What any good results will come out of this democracy summit?
Well, actually, if we think of this title of the meeting would be an academic conference or kind of an academic meeting, that would be acceptable or kind of appropriate. But if it is a country, if it is a meeting among other countries about democracy, well, I think it is a little inappropriate because as political scientists, we have basically 2 categories of political analysis. The first one is prescriptive, and the second one is descriptive. So if you are following the prescriptive political analysis, then you have a single standard, or you have the moral standard behind you, or in your mind, you are going to judge whether other countries or whether other systems are like yours or not. But if you are following the descriptive political analysis, then you show your respect to the diversity or the multiple or the plurality of the political system. You compare the differences, you compare the similarity. So if we are talking about academic conferences, then, well, people argue that this is a democracy, that is authoritarian, well, it is acceptable because that's just the descriptive terms for people to categorize different political regime. But if we talking about a meeting among the countries to view themselves as democracy, view other countries as non-democracy, I think it is a little bit inappropriate because, well, as the civilization, as a human being, as the entire human being, we respect all the diversity of the civilization, and we should also respect the diversity of the political behavior, I mean, political strategy and the political practices. So, of course, democracy is the value that should be shared by all the human beings. However, the ways to realize, the ways to materialize democracy should be multiple, should be respected in a kind of multiple way. So I would argue that the concept of democracy has already been manipulated or twisted by certain politicians with certain purposes. And that kind of conference or that kind of meeting or summit, well, it is just a kind of a political show or other kind of signal manipulation rather than having real impact on a certain solution of certain problem.
Mm-hmm. Well, John, you know, as Professor Mahoney mentioned about the, you know, U.S. probably trying to recover or, you know, regain this global leadership or hegemony, you know, but by having such a meeting, okay, 2 days, which will last for 2 days, will that somehow prop up the U.S. democracy and the U.S. global leadership?
No, it won't. I mean, firstly, you're quite right. This is, the world actually needs a great deal of unity at the present time, because there are now very, very serious problems which can't be solved by any one country. COVID can't be solved by one country. Climate change can't be solved by one country, to take only the most obvious, right? Okay, but this summit is a sort of farce. We could take the example of a country like Bolivia. Bolivia had a democratically elected government, which was overthrown by a coup d'etat in 2019, of which the United States supported the coup d'etat, therefore showing it didn't support democracy. Right. The Bolivian people, through a very heroic resistance to this, succeeded in forcing a democratic election and elected a new president, Arce. And Bolivia, however, is not invited to the summit, despite the fact that the Bolivian people have a form of democracy, and they fought very heroically to retain this democracy against an anti-democratic coup supported by the United States. Or Nicaragua, which there was a recent presidential election. The criteria why they're not elected is not because they're not democracies. They are democracies. It's because the United States doesn't like their government. And because the people elected a government that the United States disapproved of. And this just shows that the purpose of the summit is not a concept of defending democracy, it's to line up those countries which support the United States. And the claim that this is a summit of democracies, the facts show, is absolutely ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Well, Professor Mahoney, also, you know, there's a probably, if you, I mean, can characterize the preparation of the summit meeting, you can see some people that describe it as anti-China summit, because it not only invited the Chinese region, the Taiwan province, to join the meeting, but also some of the people who were involved in the Hong Kong riot, the violent protests against the government, they were also invited to join this summit. Well, there's no official representative from Beijing. So, you know, people naturally would say, oh, this is like a clique against China. Is that a fair characterization?
Yeah, I think it is. I think the, you know, to go back to your earlier question, is this really going to change a lot of people's minds? Is it really going to provide a force to allow the United States to regain hegemony? The answer is no. I mean, everyone understands that the U.S. is in decline. Everyone understands that China is rising. Everyone understands that we can either have a global conflict or we can find some way to peacefully coexist. But, you know, the interesting thing is that when you look at the intellectuals in the United States, quite a large number of them are, you know, engaging in sort of reactionary responses, and that's to be expected. But if you look at those, the conservatives, the main argument that we have today is that, in fact, the United States is not a democracy, but a republic. And this is why that the United States should try to limit voting rights. And this is why the United States should try to impose its will on competitors, most especially China. And we see this from a large number of theorists.
Right.
So I don't think that the real purpose of this meeting is to try to reestablish.
Professor Mahoney. Yeah. Well, on that note, we conclude today's show. Many thanks to our guests. You can also watch us on the CGTN app or on YouTube. I'm Xu Qinduo. You can find me on Twitter, Xu Qinduo in one word. Thanks for watching. See you next time.